Okay. Could I ask everyone to take a seat and move up a little bit? Not everyone in the back. Yeah, we're going to begin. Okay. So I hope everyone is refreshed from lunch and raring to go for the afternoon session. This is always a critical time right after lunch. I'm sure Monika Griefahn, who we're very happy to have here, is going to keep everyone very, very interested and alert with it. We're very pleased to have Monika here. She's on our board of trustees of the foundation, but she's been, I don't know of any sector you haven't worked in as founding. Exactly. NGO, Greenpeace. She's the founder of Greenpeace. She worked as CEO of Greenpeace. Then she went into politics as minister of in the Ministry for Environment in Lower Saxony in Germany, and then private sector as a consultant. So this is experience all bundled into one. And today she's going to give a masterclass on cradle to, not to grave, but cradle to cradle. And it's not only about recycling, it goes a lot beyond that. So Monika, thanks very much. Again, like this morning, please speak into the microphone when you want to ask a question. You have to wait for me to bring you the microphone because it's being put on film. And if you don't use the microphone, then the film won't pick up what you've said. So bear with us. It's a bit, you know, slows things down, but we have to work with the technology. So with that, Monika, it's hand over to you, and we're looking forward to this.
Thank you. You start, huh? Yeah, great. The microphone. Yeah, I should be an example of being... You didn't use a microphone either. Okay. Yeah, hello, and I hope we can wake up after lunch. It's always very difficult, as you say. And probably it would be good to know where you come from. My name is Monika Griefahn. You presented me already, coming from all the sectors. I was also in Parliament, which is basically the boss of the government. But most people don't realize the government is only the executive body of the Parliament, so parliaments have the power. That's why I always suggest to give... things you want to have done to parliaments, not only to governments. So that's very important. What I want to talk to you today is about cradle to cradle, because most of the people don't know what is it. And most of the people don't think there's a difference, but what you say, recycling. And that's why I want to know probably also who is here and who has ever heard about cradle to cradle. Oh, quite a lot. Oh, that's good. And then I want to know from which areas you are. Probably can make a, because we are a small group, we can make a quick round of little name and... name and organization, or so that you have that I have an idea where you come from.
Switzerland, but living in Italy. There's too many now, nuclear plants around.
Okay.
Bertram Verhaag, Germany, Munich, filmmaker. Uh-huh. And I made a film with Cradle to Cradle already.
Paul Walker with Green Cross International, Geneva, Switzerland, and Washington, D.C.
Christine Kaschner, United World College, Freiburg.
Mm-hmm. Bayou from Indonesia, student at UWC, Robert Bosch.
I'm Moritz from United World College, Robert Bosch, also as a student.
Joachim Wünning from the Stuttgart region, and we make gas burners for industrial applications.
Hildegard Breiner from Austria, Nature Conservation Union and Nuclear Resistance.
Lilian Pallas from Finland and from University of Freiburg.
I'm Kristen Eliassen from Norway, student at the University of Freiburg.
Ikram Ali from Canada, also student at the University of Freiburg.
Viviana Lopez from Colombia, also student at the University of Freiburg Environmental Governance Program.
Winfried Hoffmann, I was producing solar cells and modules in an industry.
This is Khop Narayan Shrestha from MDI Nepal, working in with agroforestry in marginal degraded lands of Nepal, sloping lands.
Liang Wen from China, student of environmental sciences in the University of Freiburg.
Ashley, I'm from Scotland, and I'm at the University of Freiburg.
Avon, I'm from the United States, but a student in environmental management at the University of Oxford.
Denise Rambaldi from Brazil, and I work with the Rio de Janeiro state government, and I work with law enforcement and also law defining the roles, and Cradle to Cradle is on our agenda.
Gerhard Knies, Hamburg. I'm a retired physicist, and I'm organizing a think tank on how can 11 billion people live on this planet without destroying it.
Heike Hüth from Bavaria. I run an engineering office for renewable energy solutions in southern countries.
Barbara Ehringhaus from Switzerland. I'm working with Transfrontier Alpine Protection.
I'm René Ngongo from Congo in Central Africa.
Sonam Wangchuk from Ladakh in the Himalayas, from Himalayan Institute of Alternatives.
I'm Samson Zagay, Country Director of Solar Energy Foundation. We distribute solar lighting system for a part of Ethiopia.
Thank you so much. That gives me a very good idea, and especially because we have some people here with solar energy, that's an important point where we think we have to improve. It's the question on solar energy is it's very important that we get it, but the panels nowadays are very different in quality, and they are still special waste. And they're still using materials which we cannot recycle. And so we have to come to a production and to selection of materials which will be possible to do that, because otherwise the solar energy is also not good enough for the future. And one point which Cradle to Cradle also takes up is the question whether we should really own all materials or all installations or machines or machinery we have, or if we simply rent them, and then the owner or the producer can keep the ownership and we only rent it. And then his interest would be much more to make good quality, because then he can longer run for instance, solar panels, if the quality is much better. So we have a big difference at the moment. For instance, Schüco, which is a German producer, has produced originally solar panels, and they keep up their energy levels up to 20 years. After 19 years, they still had 95% of their quality. And we had other solar panels, also from China, for instance, which had lost their capacity up to 70-60% after 5 years. And then it's not good enough. And it's a waste of energy and waste of resources. And that's where Cradle to Cradle tries to make an impact. If you look at the situation at the moment, and Paul was asking me before, what is it? Is it cradle to grave? That's what we have today. Humans at the moment are less intelligent than nature, because nature doesn't have waste. You know, humans produce at the moment things. They take out of the earth things. They produce something, and then they put them on the waste bin or in the deposit, or even worse, into an incineration plants, and then they... materials are away. And we think that will not help for 11 million people, as you say. The future will not be possible with taking all the materials and put them into waste. But we have to learn from nature, which has, for instance, like a tree, has leaves which fall down and get compost, which is very important for our earth. We need the soil, because at the moment with our industry, and especially with the agriculture, we lose every year 3 to 10 tons of soil by that way of producing. And we have to get the soil back. And soil is one of the issues which have not been discussed enough in the whole climate discussion, because soil keeps 75% of our CO2. So it's not only the question where do we burn fossil fuels, it's also how we keep or get back the CO2 into some ways to our Earth, and soil is one important point, and the seas, for instance, that's also discussed too few, that the seas, oceans, also are a keeper of CO2, and we make them at the moment losing their capability to keep the CO2 for us, because we're getting then acid. And that's a big point as well. So that's why we think we have waste everywhere. Everybody who makes holidays is always complaining about the waste laying around. And most people think about that household waste. But what the problem is, we have much bigger waste, which is, for instance, building industry uses a lot of waste. And we have today, for instance, laws in some countries, also in Germany, which demands to insulate houses, which makes it afterwards to a poisonous cocktail inside, because they are sometimes insulated with materials which are not good for humans. That, and you get then wet houses as well, that probably in 20 years, one third of those houses which have been insulated now have to be pulled down. That's a big amount of materials and waste which have been wasted then. So that's also one important point, that architecture and selection of materials in housing has to be selected in a proper way. And plastic waste is a very obvious one, and you can explain things on that, but it's not the biggest one. But you see that it's everywhere. The pollution and destroyed areas, you see that here. It's another award winner of Right Livelihood Award Foundation, where I'm also the chairwoman of. It's in Nigeria. We take the fossil fuels, we take the oil, and the Nigerian delta is then poisoned by the oil which is spilled there. And that gets for a lot of people, they getting sick and they cannot live there any longer. And of course, the governments and the companies don't care about it. And what we have to do is to, and that's one of the principles of Cradle to Cradle, is to produce everything with renewable energies. That's an important point. So, but on top of that, it has to be done in a way, like I said before, that the solar energy panels have to be much better and have to be also then dismantlable. That's an important part of it, so that the materials can be used again. And there we are not yet. We have today in industrialized countries a lot of problems through these policies. For instance, the biggest challenge is allergies and lung problems. For instance, asthma is one of the biggest problems for children. 40% of the children today have some kind of allergy or asthma in industrialized countries. And that gets through because 80% of the time most of the people in industrialized countries keep in houses. And that's what I explained before. They got this problem also through being in houses. And outside, of course, as well, you have a lot of conditions through traffic and through other influences. But that means that also in houses you have materials which are not good for you. For instance, laser printers. If you have a laser printer, throw it out as quick as possible then, because they have little, arrows which come out of this. There's little particles which come out of it, like arrows going into your lung. And that is not good for the humans. So particulate matters in houses, but also outside through traffic, is a very important point to get diseases like allergies or asthma. And another point is, we saw the plastic bottles before. A big issue is that, for instance, Coca-Cola company, which has, I think, 80% of the market worldwide, still uses atrazine in the bottles. And you know that with acids or with bubbles, this atrazine is solved. And that gets then into your body as well. So it would be easy to replace it. And they say, but there is no limit in the laws, which tells you that in drinks you should not have atrazine. There's a limit for drinking water. But they say very simply, we don't sell drinking water, we sell drinks. And there is no limit for that. So That's what I want to say, is we have a lot of things where we have to really reinvent products, and that's what we try to do with Cradle to Cradle. It's not only recycling in an old way, because recycling, you would think, okay, we collect the bottles and we make new products out of it, like, for instance, this pullovers you get from fleece, or you get park benches or whatever. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about selecting the right materials in the first place so that they can use them in the same quality or even in a better quality again for new products, and that you can dismantle the products in a way that it is possible to take the materials again and to select products and materials which are healthy. That's very important. So, Cradle to Cradle is a design concept which is following this idea of nature, and waste doesn't exist in this concept. So it's only everything in cycles, and that doesn't mean round cycles, it can be spirals as well. It could be other products, could be other materials. I mean, there are new inventions all the time which are good. For instance, a washing machine, after 10 years it should be replaced, but that's why we think it would be good that the owner of the washing machine is still the producer, and that a producer uses the best materials, get after 10 years, after 3,000 washing times, his washing machine back and uses the materials again for a new washing machine. Because at the moment, the washing machine after 10 years has many new features which are much better. For instance, 10 years ago, they used much more water. They used much more energy. You couldn't put in hand washing things into it. And that's sometimes important because hand washing also uses a lot of water. And if you do it in a machine and it's possible, then you use less water as if you would do it in your sink. So we propose that you only rent certain materials, because I don't want to own a washing machine, I want to wash. You know, so I buy probably 3,000 times washing. And that makes me also very conscious that I put as much as possible in the washing machine, because, for instance, for 30 degrees, I get 1 point, for 60 degrees, 2 points, for 90 degrees, 3 points, and then I'm very conscious that I don't use too much and put my full thing into the washing machine and not put only two things in that and wash and wash and wash. So I think that is a really new concept also of producing, and we have to get the owner, the producers to think in these terms. We have got now some producers, and I will show in the second part products which are also produced like that. So the principles are that every product is designed in a way that it's a nutrient for another product. So waste equals food. That means it is a new material for a new thing. Every product is produced with renewable energy. The sun is the power of everything. So also wind energy and geothermal energy are a part of solar energy. So you have to use it to produce it. And you can do it. But also you have to think about how to produce the solar energy panels. And every product contributes worldwide to diversity, either in the sense of culture or biodiversity. Also, that is important, because if you were to think very ecological, you would think probably the best is you don't use any materials any longer. And for instance, with food, you take probably a pill and a glass of water, and that is much better and ecological and would be very uniform. But we love diversity. We love to go to different kinds of food. We love to go to whatever, Turkish and Irish and whatever, different kind of food. And we love also different colors. We love different cultures. And that is very important that you consider that, that diversity is a value, and diversity of nature, of course, as well. And I remember that when I was working with Greenpeace, that sometimes somebody asked me, why do we need whales? Huh? What a question, yeah? But that's the point. It's not the question, why do we need anything? I mean, diversity as a value as such, and we enjoy it, we can learn from it. I always said, I learn from the whales that we can be cosmopolitans, because they live everywhere in the world and don't find too much with others, if we don't disturb them. So what we think is that we need to design products in a new way, that we have biological nutrients and technical nutrients. That means if you construct something which has to do with your normal day-to-day life, like shampoos or t-shirts or whatever, then it has to be from a material which is biodegradable, which can go back into nature, which can get to back into the soil, for instance, can be compostable. And you say, yeah, but that's very normal. I mean, if you have a T-shirt, that's normally from 100% cotton. That is not true. You have probably cotton in the first place, but then you have probably 30% of chemicals which are in there to keep them straight, to keep them whatever, in a certain manner that you can wash them several times, etc. And then you cannot compost them any longer because you have chemicals in them, and then the soil cannot be used any longer. Or if you have, for instance, tires for cars, at the moment, the point is that the tires keep much longer nowadays than they were several years ago. But the problem is their particular matters, which you find in the street, are so small that they also get into the lung, like I told you from the laser copying machine. So what they have to do is basically to construct a biological surrounding of the tires so that that can go into the street and be compostable. And that is a engineering challenge, but you can do it. If you give the engineer a demand, you will get the result. We know that. So I think that's the points we really have to work. Or if you have a television station or a washing machine, you really construct it in a way that you define which products are in there or which materials, and then you can get it back and can dismantle that and can get then the materials back and use it for new materials, new products. That's what we call the technical products. So there can be even toxic materials in them if they keep in the closed cycle. So if you construct it and don't have a subsidy yet, that's a point which you can have then for probably intermediate time until you find the final solution. For instance, I talked about soil. This is a very important point. I think that's one thing which has to be done up till now too few is composting, and composting in a good way. At the moment, we have the idea to export, for instance, from European or United States countries incineration plants into third world countries, and to say you get rid of your waste by incineration plants. And 80% of the materials, which are better? Incineration, also Verbrennungsanlagen. Yeah. And 80% of the materials which are used in most of the countries of the South is biological. I mean, they use a lot of fresh materials, which produces a lot of waste, which is biological. And if you would put that into an incineration plant, it doesn't burn. So, for instance, I know that the German development aid has given to India and to China money and companies to build incineration plants, and then 80% of the thing was compostable, so they had to buy 2 to 3 tons of oil per day to incinerate this, which is completely stupid. And so we think soil is a very important point, and Bertram was also in Sekem, which is very important, and they do that. They rebuild the desert by composting and by using, building up soil again, and by then planting new things on that so that you can recover the earth and can keep also the CO2 and can then build also humidity and a good vegetation there. It's a very important point that we do much too less. And the problem is at the moment that our normal lure which we have from us is not even able to get into the biological chain. For instance, with Demeter or Bioland regulations, it's not possible to put in human waste. So that we have to do as well, because otherwise, even with the biological agriculture, we lose soil because we don't get back our waste into it. You know, so the Demeter guidelines have to think about how we can do that in the future also to get back the biological waste of humans. And I think they work on that. I know that Helmi has made a working group on that in von Sekem. That's a technical cycle. That's, for instance, chairs which have been for offices. Most of people know them because they have a lot of conference rooms. And they are really recoverable in 2 minutes or even less, 30 seconds, because it's only from one material and you can use then that material again. You can melt it or you can grain it and then use it as new materials for new chairs. So the plastic which is in these chairs is not principally bad if you take the right plastics, if you don't take additives which are bad, like antimon. And you can use a new, you can produce new products out of it. So, what have to be done to create a cradle-to-cradle world? Because you think it would be so obvious to create only products which can be dismantled, which can be recycled, which can be used in biological and technical cycles. But it's not true. It's not so easy to do because it is a lot of detailed work. For instance, we had a textile forum 3 weeks ago. And then one of here by close by producer Laufenmühle, who produces clothes for work, they said they had to make a whole new process to create new knobs, new wie heißt man Faden of thread. Okay, to make it possible to dismantle or to compost it. So they had done a lot of research work because you think it should be very easy to do that, but they had to do a lot of work and they explained it, how detailed they had to go into the process to make this. But for business work, for professional clothing, for whatever, bakers and whatever, you have a lot of business work clothing, it is very obvious because normally after some time you throw it away or you get it back and you can use it again or you can compost it. And I think it's very good that he thought about it and really makes it possible. So what you have to do is, because you cannot have it everywhere back sent back to their to the owner, you have to have the waste collection companies as logistic companies as resource banks, basically. So they have to do the work to separate and to make it possible to use the materials again. Nowadays, it is very complicated. For instance, if you collect bottles or packaging material, if you have only one charge of PVC in that, it destroys the whole recycling process because PVC has a lot of components in that which make it impossible to recycle the plastic in a good way. And so we have to work on that not any packaging material is any PVC, but there is still a lot. And most of the products are not yet made for separation, disassembling, recycling. And they are not selected with materials which are healthy. That's what I explained to you in the that in housing, for instance, see carpets or painting or whatever. There are a lot of materials which have a lot of toxic stuff in it. For instance, the glues for the carpets. They are very often very dangerous and very toxic. So if you go into new houses, you sometimes feel it. You feel the smell, and sometimes people get headache and so on if you are in new houses. And then you know there are materials which are not made for indoor use. And especially if the house are very well insulated, like they are nowadays, if you build them new, you have even more problems. So you have to be more selective on that. So the problem is to bring together the recycling quality and the health quality in the selection, in the design process. And so what we have today is too many different kinds of materials in one product. Different materials glued together, that's also a problem, which cannot be separated again. Too many dangerous materials or components, chemicals, heavy metals that affect the health and the environment afterwards. And producers often do not know the components of their products. That's also important. And the missing infrastructure for really recycling in a way that you can use it as a bank or as a logistics center. So, and what of course is still done is use of fossil energy that we have to reduce as well. So that's part of the whole concept. So it's not that you say you have a lot of energy and you can do it again. You can do it if you have renewable energies. So you have to really do selected. If you have products which go into the environment, they have to be constructed for a biological cycle. They have to be constructed that can go into water, into the soil, or into the air. So they have to be fully biodegradable. And products who do not go away, machines, interior designs, they have to be built that they can be disassembled. And for instance, use glues which you can put into, for instance, enzyme bars and separate that again. You have glues which are possible to put in enzyme bars and not throw away because they are glued together. But you have to think about it beforehand. That's the important point. So, and producers have to take their products back or own it so that they use the best materials. That's the ideal world. So examples, this is for instance a German t-shirt company which really has implemented all this, and you can see that they can even biodegrade the t-shirt, which is not possible with most of the t-shirts nowadays. You have a lot of other examples like toilet paper, for instance, also a very important point, especially in three southern countries, because you buy toilet paper and it's not biodegradable. You know that they have a lot of etihedrine, which is a material which glues the paper together, and that doesn't dissolve. That is not compostable. And especially if you have compost toilets or if you have toilets which are... which have very few water, then you need it. And also in European or in United States countries, it is important to not put too much things into the water, because water is a very scarce good. So toilet paper is a very important point to think about and to use the right materials. Or cosmetics and cleaning materials. So they can be very easily reproduced or rethought to be more, to be able to be compostable or to get into the water. Or, for instance, like this material which you put on the floor, this is a material which has been produced in a way that can be re-given to the company. They shredder it and then they make new materials out of it. And it is not glued with a glue which is not solvable. So that's very important. And on top, it has another quality. It has an air cleaning quality. So that is very important also to think, how can you clean the air indoor, which is sometimes also has a lot of particles running around. Or, for instance, bricks. This TV from Philips, for instance, the first one, which has no PVC and no heavy, no scarce material in it. Also very important, because that's where we have really problems, is to get the scarce materials. Wie heißen die nochmal, die raren Rohstoffe, die seltenen Rohstoffe?
Rare minerals.
Okay, yeah. They don't have that, because that's one problem which we have worldwide, that they are basically in two countries, in China and Kazakhstan, and we have problems to get them. So to construct something which makes it without PVC, without scarce materials, it's very important. Or in the building, it's also to have a building which is like a tree, which is really healthy for the people and for the environment, and which after whatever 20, 40, 100 years you can dismantle and use the materials again, because it's not all toxic and it's not insulated in a way with materials which makes you thick. So this is, for instance, the townhouse of Venlo, which has been constructed in this way. And to have a little green in the town is also very important, because that cleans the air outside as well. That's the quality of life, of course, if you do that. And it's a question of planning. And it doesn't have to cost more. That's very important. I mean, the town of Venlo has participated with people to do that, and it costs not more. Yeah, and what we want to do is not to say we want to leave a less negative footstep on the Earth, but we want to leave as humans a positive footstep on the Earth. And that's the important point, and that's what we want to encourage. And our association is a non-profit association, and we have in Germany, for instance, at the moment, about 50 groups with a lot of volunteers who try to promote this idea. and go to companies and go to universities to create this atmosphere to make it and to make also the whatever the institutions and so to buy these materials so that there is a market, because you need a market to start first. And I was very proud that, for instance, a group in either Stuttgart or Tübingen went to their university and they bought all these cleaning materials and all these things so that they changed their procurement in that so that you get the market to do that and make it cheaper and more because you need a big production to do that. So I have brought you some materials and you can look at it and I will present it a little bit. Ja, das können wir noch mal lassen. For instance, I have brought here, that looks very funny because this is for cleaning your shoes. And this can be very easily dismantled. That's simply a design, you know. You have to think about how to put this design. I give it around. Or this little toy. You have a lot of toys which are basically toxic. And if children take them into the mouth, they're getting a lot of chemicals with that. They have thought about how to do this toy, and they have selected the material so that people with little children can eat them, you know. Or this bottle, you know, you can have and drink it, can fill your water in it, and you can, you can easily recycle, and it has no anthracene in it. Was habe ich denn noch hier? Well, this is here for the floor. Beside the carpet, you have here this parquet, which is very nice, which I really like, and has a very good atmosphere if you have it in the house. Oh, they are different. They have it from all.
The way it's treated.
Yeah, the way it's treated, and it's made so that it is possible. You know, to put it in the house and it keeps for a long time and it's nevertheless can be reused or recycled if you put it out after whatever 20, 30, 40 years. This carpet I was talking about. You have it also in a thicker way, but I put this with me because it's very often used in offices. This is our first Congress, and there are some English articles in there. That's why I brought it. And this paper is also made in this way, with the glues, with the colors, with everything, so that can it be compostable. So you can cut this and put it into the compost if you are, have read enough of it. Okay. Same with this little paper thing here. Yeah, these are only, or here's a little book which explains it for children. It's probably also interesting. Excuse me, because my nose is running, I have to. Yeah, before we go into the question of what can everybody do, and I wanted to make some small groups, I first wanted to ask you whether you have questions on that, what I presented, because I made it in a little rush, and sometimes you have to explain it a little bit more detailed, but I try to make it as quick as possible.
You showed about these magazines.
Yeah.
I've been wondering for a long time, maybe you could take the idea somewhere. Mm-hmm. Magazines and newspapers that are read in a day or a week do not have to be so permanent. Mm-hmm. So if there could be some ink, preferably natural.
That's in there, yeah.
Wait, I'm saying something different. With which you print it, and it doesn't have to last forever. Something that you can dip in water, and all the ink goes after you have read, and becomes a notebook on which children can write. Is that possible? Can you take it somewhere?
Okay.
So many children need notebooks.
Hey, start a startup, see?
Yeah.
Monika, thanks. That was a very nice presentation. I bet all of us in the room here are very much in favor of this. I think the major question is this something that needs to be regulated and mandated, or are you thinking more along voluntary lines? I mean, it seems in a lot of the work we do in the environmental community, you know, your conservatives. In the United States, we think of the Republicans mostly, and certainly Donald Trump today wants it to be voluntary. And of course, we know that there are certain companies and certain political philosophies and all that, you know, won't do anything that's regulated or very much against federal or state or local regulations. So should we mandate some of this stuff? Should we have environmental regulations around all this? Or should we just try to work on public awareness and urge people to do the right thing?
I think the problem is that it goes very slow if you do it voluntarily. And so what we always thought was not to regulate it into frameworks, but probably to have directives with goals. And what you could do is public procurement. That is a very important and very powerful tool, because the public procurement is the biggest buyer of a lot of things. So we are working at the moment, for instance, with the Ministry of Development to put it into their installments so that they can also get it into countries they are working with. Because I think if you have procurement guidelines, then you can distribute things very easily. And we have worked with the EU to make a guideline on a design, which is not only a design directive which says you have to recycle, but you have to think in it beforehand. And so I think to put goals is very important. And the goal would be probably, I say that at the moment for a lot of countries not realistic, but I think we could aim on that to say until 2030 we will not have any incineration plant any longer. Not that I want that it is dumped anywhere again, but that we have a goal to change the production, that there is no waste any longer which has to be incinerated. It's probably not the right goal, but only to think about it and to make it more happening. And because a lot of companies invest a lot, but in the competitive scene, they have not always a chance. For instance, I made first, and that's already 25 years ago, I made the first computer with Hewlett Packard, which was only from one material, could be dismantled within minutes, seconds. And we presented it on the CeBIT in Hannover, which is the biggest fair on these issues. But that's 25 years ago. But because the competitors didn't have that, it had no advantage. And there was no directive for returning the electronic goods, which we now have. But this returning directive is not good enough yet, because you don't keep the ownership for the materials, so that you don't have to use the best materials to make it possible. So probably we have to make a mixture of awareness plus some directive to make it possible and have the procurement going into this directive. Like environmental paper, we have started by procurement, you know. Otherwise, it would not be today the normal way of using it, you know. Please.
Exactly to that point, there are always two possibilities. You can make a law, and like, for example, in Europe, what we did with the energy-saving lamps. That was done by law, but the industry was not ready, and we know what happened. They created the lamps with mercury inside. There is a much better way.
That's a wrong thing, yeah.
That's very wrong. So I always look in Japan, what they have with this, I think it's a so-called forerunner project.
Yeah, genau, frontrunner.
By year, they set a goal. The best products from industry gets awarded, and next year, the old ones are forbidden. So that makes sure that the industry has time to adapt to it, and you get then, time by time, the better product. So that may be a good way.
Actually, I have asked for that already 20 years ago when I was an environmental minister, but I have not yet the majority. So that needs a public awareness and the lobbying, you know.
And may I just make one small clarification for solar modules, because that is what I did 40 years. The solar modules, at least 90% of them, they are normal Hausmüll, so to say, but because they have a little junction box at the back which have to contain two diodes, and that is why they are not supposed to be normal waste. So all you have to do is take the junction box away. The rest is glassed, and for the future, by the way, it's all based on sand. You have the glass for the encapsulation. You have silicone for the encapsulation material. You have the silicon wafer. You have copper, for example, for all the for the metal to get the electricity out. That's all. So for the future, we have no problem whatsoever.
Yeah, but the copper you have to get back.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And that still is not done. That's why I say I would prefer
it could be done, but at the moment, it's not paid for. So therefore, it is not done. So there has already been 10 years ago a plant which was able to dismantle solar modules and to get back all these precious elements. Unfortunately, there was no payment, and it was more expensive to get that back instead of taking new ones. So we have to encourage and do all the various steps to do it properly.
That's why I think incentive to keep the ownership from the producer is much bigger possibility to have the materials weighed in this way. Because when I look at German producers, their lifetime and their production time is much better than others. But they died because they had no incentive possibilities. I agree. But we need some lobby for that, you know. And that's, as you say, it's not so easy that you simply say that's there. But we need to push it. And I agree, there are a lot of companies who have possibility, like phosphate, we need to get back as well. There is a phosphate getting back company in Netherlands which just died as well because it's not paid for.
I'm the moderator, so I'm not supposed to ask questions, but I'll abuse my position here with the microphone and ask you a question. I mean, like everything else, it comes down to here, right? The price?
Yeah.
And, I mean, this is a broader, you know, broader question of how do we end this, in German, this Geizesgeil, you know, the cheaper the better. We want everything cheap, cheap, cheap. And then there's the expression, but you get what you pay for. Was nicht kostet, ist nicht. So, you know, people say poor people with little money really can't afford to buy cheap because that stuff doesn't last. And so you're replacing those products more often than if you invest from the beginning a little bit more and then you have it longer. And so, you know, industry is just going to follow that mentality, right?
Yeah, but that's again why I say I'm very much for this leasing concept, because if I have a washing machine and buy 3,000 times washing and not a washing machine, I don't buy the service. And if we get this, then we have the producer who produces the best thing, and he has an interest that it takes or rests for the whole time it is there. He doesn't want to come there all the time to repair it. And you have an incentive to use it the best way because you pay for the points, you know, you pay 1.30 degrees, 2.10. Then it is, I think, a good incentive because I only pay what I really use. Yeah, I pay 3,000 times my washing. And then the owner, the producer comes and gets my washing machine back or the TV station or whatever. Because I don't want to own special waste. I mean, in a TV station, there are at the moment 1,460 chemicals in there. I don't want to own special waste. I want to look television. And I think with the money, we can explain, and for instance, with the carpet, we could show that the carpet is even cheaper if you produce it in that way, because you don't have all these different deposit necessities, you know. If you have different chemicals, you need special areas to keep them and so on. If you have good quality and only one material, you need much less. So it could be even cheaper.
I'm sure you are using paper handkerchiefs. I'm also sorry I cannot give you a second one like this, because this is made of wood. This is only cellulose. And one of the most dangerous products we use in environmental terms is cotton, because cotton is the agricultural production which needs the highest amount of water, the highest amount of chemicals, and the highest amount of pesticide. So it's very good to have hired wash machine or not, but people don't know. people on the street don't know that cotton is a very, very ugly and earth-destroying material, and that you can get a very good textile of Laureates, Laureates been produced in Austria for much better using quality and for which lasts like linen. And there is another one which is not known, and I would be happy if you could talk about. This is cement lightment. Mm-hmm. This is the new cement invented at the University of Karlsruhe, mm-hmm. which needs only a chemical process temperature of about 400 to 500 degrees, mm-hmm. not 1,200 like normal cement.
I agree, and we have a lot of, I showed only very few products. We have also, for instance, from stone paper, and there are a lot of possibilities, and we have a lot of products of wood as well. So it is very important, but it's a question of the companies that they invest in analyzing what materials they put into it, you know. So for varying, you can have this and this and this, I agree.
With regard to the use of water, I know that you cannot destroy water. You only can pollute it. Mm-hmm. Now, does the cotton pollute the water, or does it only use it as a subsidiary thing to grow? Yeah. And then it evaporates the water, and it is back in the environment, and it comes down as rain again. So it is a cycle of such a cotton.
If you look at the Aral Sea, you know that it has been reduced quite a bit because they had made cotton fields around there, and it has really brought a lot of people a destruction of their life because they were before fishermen at the Aral Sea, and people couldn't live at the water any longer. Aral Sea in Soviet Union, in former one.
Well, but this is something different. If you use up a water which is not replenished, but just the use of water itself, it's not the point.
The question is where you have it and where you keep it. Yeah.
If you overuse a reservoir, it always gets empty.
Yeah, for instance, that's what we said with Sekem, for instance, which uses the compost to keep also the water there so that they can live there and build up new crops and plants and so, you know.
Hi there. I just wanted to ask to what extent you think a cradle-to-cradle economy needs to also be a more local economy, because there's two points I'm thinking. The first is obviously the transport costs of moving products to their destination, but also taking them back to the producer or to resource banks, as you term them. And then also, I've heard it said that one of the reasons why cradle-to-cradle might cost more is because materials are currently cheaper than labour costs. But of course, labour costs are one of the whole reasons why the economy has become so globalised. So if we were to start valuing labour more, to what extent do we have to shorten our supply chains?
That's why I talked about, the logistics centres of, companies which at the moment are waste management companies, to make them to logistic resource organisers. Because, of course, it's not good to retransport whatever, a solar cell to China or whatever, but to use the materials here again. And then with this system of banks, of resource banks, you can then exchange from the companies what they had put into them and get that regionalized back, you know. And, I mean, we were talking about companies which were pioneers in that, and most of them are middle-sized companies. They're not huge companies. And most of them are really either owner-driven or middle-sized companies which are trying to really do the best. And we have the advantage in Europe that in a lot of countries, either Netherlands or Germany or other countries as well, Denmark, Sweden, we have 80% of our economy on small companies. It's basically owner-driven or middle-sized companies, and they do a lot of these investments. And if they don't do it, the big companies normally are not doing it. They're following, probably.
So you said you wanted to put us in groups?
Yes,
because we have 30 minutes.
Yes, I wanted to make...
But we have a question.
question. Well, if you have questions, it's better to do the questions, yeah.
Sorry, I have three questions in one time to my brain.
Yeah, it's fine. No problem. So,
firstly, I talked to someone yesterday from food industry. Mm-hmm. I told her that I love your product, but that would be better if you replace your package material instead of plastic. But she told me that they've thinking about it, but then they cannot make sure that it will be free from bacteria. So they think it difficult. So how do you think about all the package material in our supermarket? That's a lot of. How do you think about it? First,
Now I think it's very important. That's why I said before, packaging material is in some areas important, and plastic could be used. We have a lot of possibilities to produce plastic. We don't need oil for that. We have a lot of plastic waste today to produce from wood or from other materials. That's not the point. The question is that you have basically monomaterials and that you can really collect them and use them again, and that you don't have added chemicals like we have today in the bottles, this atrazine, which is basically get into the body and or in the environment. And so the question is, again, the quality of the material and the way of production. And I can understand that if you have hygienic problems or this kind of things, that you need some kind of packaging, but you can think about the packaging. So we want to make our next workshop, which we have done now on textile and on building, exactly on packaging, because we know that a lot of companies are working on that to make it better.
And secondly, I know that the good design is very important, but on the other side, how about change people's idea? Do we really need to use cosmetic? Do we have to take shower once every day?
That's a good point for Cradle to Cradle. That's why we love diversity. For instance, every woman uses 4.6 kilo lipstick in her life, you know, average. Some people more, some less. You can say you don't need it. But that's the point, you know. What Cradle to Cradle wants is not to make things bad and unify everything to one thing. That's why I talked about the tablet and the water. That would be enough for eating, but it's not joy. I love eating, and I love the diversity of eating. So, and that's the same with the lipstick. I think we need the products to be well-defined and to be selected and to know what materials are in there. And we know that if I have a lipstick, then it goes back into nature and is no problem. And the question of shower, and yeah, that's a question you always have to discuss in the area where you have few water. I think it's very important to have then water selection or water saving programs. But the question is, in other areas, you have a lot of water. I mean, we're making now ecological footprint discussions on chocolate and cacao. But you know that the cacao and the chocolate is coming from rainforests, where a lot of rain is coming down anyway. So that is not a problem. It's a question on how you produce it afterwards. Yeah, it's not the question that you couldn't have any chocolate beans or so produced, because they are in the rainforest where it's raining anyway. Yeah, it's more the problem of cutting the rainforest. Rain, you can talk about it because they're cutting down the rainforest that gets away the CO2. Collector, and it gets away the possibility to build up soil again and to collect the CO2 out of the atmosphere back, you know. That we have to do.
Thanks. And last about the product, come back to did your community think about to collect all your product to open a shop so that we can go directly go there?
Yeah, there is an initiative from the first group in Lüneburg, which is also in a university which does a lot of sustainability thing. And there, from this university, there had been built an initiative which has built a shop now, which is called Cradle Unit. Maybe it has this nochmal genau. Cradle World or something like that. You can look into our website, you will find it. And they sell all this stuff as well, so they collect it all.
Yes, just my curiosity. Yes, that it is true that things are getting complex and complex every day in our life. Maybe due to we have to change our lifestyle to reduce this all this pollution. That is one part. And going to this bottle, there is a specific reference that the safe drinking water can be supplied, especially in Nepal, that has been written in this pamphlet. Ismail,
yeah. What is the problem? Sorry, I didn't get the problem.
Projects in Nepal. How we can make this safe with this bottle?
What you can do?
Safe water.
You can basically, this only one material, and that's a good thing about it. It's no atrazine and so on. So you can afterwards shred it and make new materials out of it, new products out of it. It's very easy to...
Using this bottle.
Yeah, you can use it, 100 times, and if you can't use it any longer, then you can shred it and make new new plastic materials out of it, new bottles out of it.
Oh, thank you.
So, but you can use it 100 times, you know, 200 times, you know. I have one of this quite, I think, 6 years now or so. And I use it all the time when I go somewhere. Okay. No more questions? Yeah, please.
Yeah, one very good example is the small country in Africa, Rwanda. Mm-hmm. In Rwanda, plastic bags and plastic bottles mm-hmm. are just forbidden mm-hmm. by law.
That's one way, yeah. That's a question of Paul, how much you can do via legislation, yeah. Yeah. You have you to do that by legislation or not, yeah.
Maybe here is somebody from India who can tell us about this, that they don't use any more plastic bags.
In Ireland, I think they have stopped it as well, no? Yeah. In Ireland, they have forbidden it as well.
Rewe, the retail, the supermarket chain, they had this big campaign with, I think, WWF, no more plastic bags, we're banning plastic bags. And my husband came home from Rewe with a brown paper bag, and it said, you know, Rewe bans plastic bags. And then he started to take things out, and everything was in plastic. The apples were in plastic. The lettuce was in plastic. The yogurt...
I think that's what the gentleman there said, that what do you do?
Exactly,
yeah, yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
You wanted to say something? Yeah. Plastic. Even in Eritrea, the plastic has been avoided. So no plastic is since 5 years ago.
I didn't get that, sorry.
Eritrea.
Eritrea.
Yeah, the plastic has been avoided and no plastic is not allowed 5 years ago.
So there was a question about India. So I've been there just pretty recently, and my parents have been there. So what, for example, they did in, I think, in some Himalaya region, they've banned like plastic bags completely, and now they substituted it with, like, for example, bags made of old newspaper as a substitute. But in other regions, it just not really did work out. So I was speaking to some locals, and they just told me that there is a law which forbids it to use them. But somehow, just no one really cared when it was implemented, and still everyone used it. So it's like always a difference between the law and the execution of it.
Yeah, I think it is probably a little bit unrealistic to get people carrying their glass bottles around, because they are all movable now. And the question is whether this bottle, which can be used 100 times or 200 times, and then used again as material, is not an intermediate way, because glass bottles is also a problem, you know, because they get broken and they can hurt. So it's also a question of the...
And what about using organic materials to produce plastics, as potatoes, sugar
cane? Yeah, that's what I said. There are a lot of other options, like wood and
but
things.
But don't you think we are competing for food to produce plastic? We are using...
We shouldn't use it for fuel, that's for sure. I mean, we have a lot of... In Germany, for instance, we have a lot of corn fields, which are producing... fuel or biogas, and that's not a good option, I think. That's a competition on fuel, on food. But to do it for instance, waste using or cellulose rests or so using, it's possible.
But even considering that alcohol used as fuel is emit much less carbon or almost nothing than fossil fuel, because we use a lot of ethanol in Brazil. And done from sugar cane. And the rest we produce cachaça that we drink to forget our problems, you know.
Yeah, I know that cachaça is very loved in Germany as well. With Caipirinha, exactly.
But what is wrong with copper? Is copper toxic?
No, copper is not wrong. It's only that you have to get it back because it's very rare, scarce.
But this is not a problem.
It I is a problem. You have
humanity,
to get it back.
Humanity is ingenious enough to invent new conductors. So, for instance, you can use aluminum, you can...
Aluminum is really even worse because you need you need for two cans of aluminum. It's a household use of a family with four people, you know. I mean, this is really bad, I think.
What is the problem? You need energy to produce it. If the energy is clean, then it's no problem.
Yeah, but what I say is, for instance, at the moment, I think China bought 80% or 90% of the copper which we have at the moment on digged out, you know? And so it's a scarce material, so you better recycle it, not throw
it
away.
Sure, I'm not opposing it, but it's not toxic. It is only of commercial.
That's what I'm not was talking about. I was talking with the solar panels. I was not talking about toxic. Mm. I was talking about that it is at the moment only waste, and you throw it away. Mm-hmm. And that's what I wanted to change.
Yes, and there are new panels around which don't use these rare materials or rare earths. So I think we can solve those problems. But there are others which we cannot solve or not easily solve. So if it is toxic...
I think we can solve all the problems if we select the right materials from the beginning. That's mm-hmm. It's my thesis. And that's the philosophy of Cradle to Cradle. And that's what I want to do, mm-hmm. that we really reinvent all products, all mm-hmm. services, mm-hmm. everything new. That's the idea, mm-hmm. basically. Mm-hmm. And that we have to move and to go. And the question is how we get a movement, that it is mm-hmm. natural to do it in this way, and mm-hmm. whether we need some legislation or procurement directives or some goals mm-hmm. to mm-hmm. set, you know, like sustainability goals. You could also mm-hmm. set a goal. We want to use 100% of the materials again. It could mm-hmm. be one sustainability goal. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not in there yet. But that would be something. If you have put the right goals, then you come there. I'm sure you can solve the problem.
And what do you think about urban mining?
I mean, this is basically after it has been produced already. I mean, what we do at the moment, for instance, with handies or with mobile phones, everybody says they are recycled. But what we take out is probably 9% of the materials. All the rest is still waste. What we put out is probably a little bit of gold, a little bit of silver, if you are lucky, a little bit of copper. All the rest is thrown away. Mm-hmm. So the design of the mobile phones is not yet that you use 100% of the materials again. That's why I say it's urban mining basically take out of the waste bins what you have not constructed in the right way. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a problem. For instance, if you produced, if you got copper in the beginning, it has still 3% contents in the, if you mined it. Mm-hmm. If you have it nowadays, you find only 0.3% contents in it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and if you get it in urban mining, it's even less. Mm-hmm. And that's what I mean. You have to have the construction in a way mm-hmm. that you re-get the mm-hmm. material. I'm not talking about recycling, I'm re-getting the material. Mm-hmm.
Do you know what they use in India instead of plastic bottles? Because when I was there were tremendous of plastic bottles. Yes.
I thought they were talking about plastic bags only, yeah? Mm. Not bottles. That's a problem, yeah? That's why I'm talking about these other ones, which you can refill and reuse all the time, you know?
It obviously takes a tremendous amount of effort for companies that are already producing goods to transform to this type of system, from how they design to the materials they use, their whole business model, whether they switch to a renting model. In terms of how governments or NGOs or even consumers seek to support that, do you think it's more likely that companies can change, or are we looking at a whole new startup culture around Cradle to Cradle?
No, I think really that companies can change, and those who have done, they are even successful. I mean, it's probably hard in the beginning because the process to analyze what materials have I done up till now into changing into it is sometimes a little bit stressful. But I tell you one story from CD, which is a German company to produce soaps and stuff like that. And they had a shower gel, material for with 29 different chemicals. So they analyzed it and they thought, oh God, we need 29 different pots of keeping the materials and so on. So even the materials were very cheap. In the combination, it was very expensive. By analyzing it and reinventing the same material, they had only afterwards 9 components. So each component was probably more expensive, but the handling was much cheaper. So finally, this whole thing was much cheaper. So the big company could do it. And the thing what I told about this business or professional clothing, it's the same. It's the company who is here. And of course, to make this process first, to analyze the materials which are in and then change it, it's probably a little bit difficult, but afterwards the handling is much easier because you have no special waste, you have no extra fees to pay to get the special waste away. And the health of the people who work with it is much better. Working health is also important. And the people who are in the working places are much healthier with that. So it's a benefit for them. So the profit can be there. The carpet company, even in 2010, when there was a big crisis through the banking crisis, they were the only carpet company who had raise of their income because they were not more expensive but cheaper because the handling is so much easier for them in the production. So, but they had to make a process in the first way. That's a difficult thing.
So my question is, well, this Cradle to Cradle is a very great initiative, but I don't know if you guys have considered it, is does it only target a certain socioeconomic group? And how do you have it so that it diffuses into the greater population? So have you considered working with municipalities or schools so that it isn't only for people that can afford it? Even it is a very logical business model, but you know it's hard for other people of a certain standing to maybe understand or this.
No, that's a very important point of the work, to work with schools, to work with universities, and to work with people. For instance, we have one project in Louisiana where the people had all lost their houses through the big storm. And there was an initiative, because architecture is so important, to make very cheap houses for the people, which they could rebuild inside themselves, but the whole construction was done by the initiative. And so they got very quickly their houses, and they got good materials and healthy materials. And that's a very important point. It was for very poor people who lost their houses there in the big storm. No, it's very important to do that.
I have an information question. If in China, from the bottles, from the plastic bottles, our clothing is made, is there this atrazine, as you told, also in it?
Oh, and shit. Also these materials have then also the problem with the microplastic in the seas, because that goes through the washing machines into the sewage plants, and the sewage plants don't have these big filters, have the filters, but the filters are not small enough that they keep them, because otherwise they could clean the whole time. So the microplastic problem is also got through the remake of the bottles pullovers.
My question is, how do you think Cradle to Cradle can work together with other initiatives such as circular economy or the economy for common goods? Because it seems, or at least what I perceive it is, that these different initiatives run differently, and not even though they have similar goals or have a lot of similar goals, but
I agree. I mean, the point of circular economy is that things really are still in this recycling terms. And what cradle to cradle differs is you have to do more work in the beginning. And I know a lot of companies who are in both initiatives, but they finally thought, oh, circular economy, it's much easier. Because you only have to think afterwards, what do you do with the things, you know? And a very bad example is, for instance, I don't know whether you know that, there are bags from truck plants, you know, which they have over the trucks, and they are very fashionable, Freitag. But the problem is that's PVC with additives which are very not good for your health, and especially if students, which have only one room, have these bags there, then you get all this PVC additives into your body, and that's not good for you. And so the circular economy sometimes stops too early in this initiative, because they think really in circulars. And what we think is not in circulars, but in continuous processes, and in the beginning of the process, so important. And that's probably the important thing for the companies, which makes them feel that the energy is too much, you know? They need to put first in to reinvent their product. That's a lot of energy we need. And if you have this goal, so if you have something, you know, as an incentive, that would be much better. And of course we work with them together. And if you see the Alan MacArthur Foundation has made two, which does circular economy, has two publications, and in both of them, the cradle-to-cradle elements are in. But the companies who are in this initiative from Al MacArthur, they pay $10,000 a year or whatever and say, oh, we are in a circular economy club, and they not doing this, you know, thinking from the beginning. That's a problem, you know. And we try to promote that more also in this initiative. We are not competitors. We say we have to promote this more, you know. Because we're thinking also not only in recycling but in health. That's, I think, the big difference, you know. Health for the people and health for the environment. Not only in recycling that you use the resources again. It's not only resource, it's efficiency, it's more.
You mentioned how important it is to have in future 100% from renewables, wind and solar. What are you doing in order to promote that?
For instance, with solar energy producers, to do that what before it was said, that we try to get the best solar energy panels so that we get really more solar. Wind energy, we try to work with, you know, dismantlable wind energy turbines with companies. That's basically the two projects we have at the moment. And we work with universities to continue on that, of course. Because we cannot do everything ourselves. I think the main thing is to get a lot of universities to follow this path, you know.
I'm not sure if you spoke to this already and maybe I missed it, but can you talk a little bit about the certification process? If there is one, is it for companies or for products specifically? How much does it cost? How easy is it for companies to access the certification, those sorts of things?
You know, the certification is a very American model of doing things. And basically, we are not so keen on it. We think it would be the best to have a transparent process on your internet site, website. But as Americans really like labels, you have to have the certification process. So we have given it to an independent foundation, which is called Cradle to Cradle Certified Org. Which does a checklist and a process for certification, and that is basically for companies, for the process, and for products. So you both have that. But I promote also companies who don't do the certification, because of course it costs money, because I say if you make your process very transparent and you show which materials you use and how you do it, then it's as good. For instance, for little startups who try really to change things, they cannot pay for certification on top of it.
I guess I just wonder about in trying to make this more consumer-facing, how you can communicate. A consumer might not go to the trouble of trying to find out if a certain company has checked all these boxes and instead is going to look at a label that's right there when they're purchasing
the
product.
That's true. It is true, but it's for, especially for small companies, sometimes the certification process is very complicated. That's a problem. And that's why it is helpful if a company then, if it's a startup, makes it transparent and they're as good as than the certified. But you're right, if you have a label, and I had some products with labels put around, then it's easier for consumers to do that. That's right. So we missed the little groups, but there were so many questions. I think it's better to answer the question because I know that the concept is a little bit more complicated than simply circular economy. And I hope I could explain that a little bit better now.
Yes, you did. And yeah, there was a lot of interest. So thank you so much, Monika Griefahn, and a nice round of applause. And good luck with that. And good luck with that, And you'll be around.
Yeah, we need more, so people engage in your communities, neighbors, universities, etc. Freiburg, I think, has a group, so you could participate.
Okay. And you'll be around, so you can have some further conversations with Monika. Okay. Coffee break, and then we're back in here at 2:45. And here, don't forget your product, your packets. The group picture is going to be taken, so everyone follow Jeanette. On the balcony of the first floor where all the flags are, that's where the picture will be taken.